Hello, hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode on the 0% here on YouTube, one of our outlets for the actual site. You may visit us at www.the0percent.net. We have now migrated from Patreon over to the0percent.net. So, what we have today, I'd like to discuss the continuation of the actual non-UCC. Some of you have put together your non-UCC recorded in the county, and that information was very necessary. It recorded your promissory notes, it established your express trust, that it is the secured party, not to be confused with the secured party creditor. We know that there's no such thing as the SPC process. We do not teach that here. And if you've done that, come and see what we have going on online so you can see the difference and see all of the testimony to everything outside of SPC. So recording your documents down in the county is what allowed your first step to obtaining the 0% tax bracket. Now, there is a continuation process. You will need that information that you've obtained from your county seat, the booking number, the page number, the file number. All of that information will be carried on and merged to the next non-UCC. So that way you can do what's called the final UCC3 amendment, a termination. What am I talking about? I'm talking about terminating that initial agriculture lien that the Federal Reserve System, United States Treasury, we've all seen that lien that's out there that is against all real people with real arms and legs up to about $14 quadrillion. That lien was not recorded as a non-UCC, which is the real lien. So therefore, they gave you an out if you know about it. So you have to cancel this this lien that is against you. Now it's made for everybody. I'm going to show you how the world's powerful Italian black nobility families have come together and put together a pope. The three major popes, the black, white, and the gray, and how everybody who was born here in the United States, or if you are naturalized here in the United States, you are all Catholic. Even if you are from another country and your country has issued you a birth certificate of some sort, you are Catholic in origin. It doesn't matter if you're Mormon, if you practice Judaism, it doesn't matter. But there is a way around it. This goes all the way back to the days of 1302, the year 1302. So I have some notes here. I'm going to break this down into three parts. So please watch all three parts. Those that are members, you will have the option to see the actual non-UCC recordings and how to further those recordings into the next phase, which will lead you to the UCC3 termination. If you're not a member, please go and join 0%.net. Go to the bottom and you may find some of the plans that may be to your liking. So I'm going to share my screen and we are going to get into the notes and start reading how exactly are we owned and in trouble by the Vatican, the Roman Catholic Church. So these notes will be for you all, if you are a member, so that you may go back to them and utilize the information in this video to further your process. So this is part one. In this lesson, we will go over the second part of the Uniform Commercial Code filing and our process of not only obtaining 0% tax liability, but for absolute freedom and the liberty from bondage back to our birthright of natural inhabitants on the land of the great I am. Those of you know, that is God, what we call God. He is everywhere. He is electric. He is magnetism. He is light. He is everything. And his name is I Am. Why? Because when you say it, it's personal. If I say I Am, his name is I Am. Therefore, he is with me. He's omnipresent. He's inside with me, as he is with you. And so the great I Am has what's called common law. Every land has their own common law according to that culture that is on that land. And that is the law under God. So the first non-UCC registered your authenticated birth certificate. If you haven't done that, please go to the freshman class and get that done. There's also a free video on YouTube on this channel, how to do that. So your authenticated birth certificate with the lien, that's the promissory note. Remember, we are following the laws of banking as they do. Now you must use that recorded info to use it with the second round, which leads to a specific UCC termination. As you know, right now, in our current condition, it is all about maritime law, the law of the waters, and governed by admiralty law. And those that desire to fulfill the biblical treaty statement, come out of her, my people, must follow these procedures. Make no mistake, it is all under Roman Catholic Church. It's under the Roman Catholic Church, no one else. The filing within an organic public record has been a confusing subject as to what property secured by a security interest could be perfected or not perfected. The UCC law can be a daunting source to fully comprehend its meaning and applicability. However, once fully understood, we can all use the UCC as instructions and dig our way out of being surety for others' debts on the citizenship of maritime law. Pay very close attention in this lesson because I'm going to be giving a lot of words that we can define. We will be using the Black's Law Dictionary. We know that that is not a lawful dictionary. However, it is approved by the ABA, the American Bar Association. Those words are used in law, but it is not a law dictionary. I recommend Ballantine's Dictionary for Law or the American Jurisprudence. So stick with me. We're going to go over a lot of definitions. We're going to go over a lot of history in this lesson so that we can understand why we are in this position. Why are we stuck? Why doesn't this feel right? Why can't we get ahead? Why is inflation always our responsibility when they cause it? Why? And I hope you understand it after watching these three parts. So we're going to dive into biblical treaty law in this review and dive into the UCC to comprehend the difference between UCC-1 financing statements and non-UCC recorded or unrecorded filing systems, as well as imperative Black's Law definitions. As I said before, keep in mind, Black's Law is not an actual law dictionary, but it is the language of the American Bar Association. So let's begin. Maritime law is all about etymological understanding. Mari, Mary. Mary comes from the Virgin Mary of the Bible. And we also see her depicted as Our Lady Star of the Sea, just translated in Latin as Stella Maris. In other words, the constellation of Mars or the Catholic Mariology. You may click these links and it will take you directly to Wikipedia. It's gonna give you the etymology and history of Stella Maris, all right? Please check that out. Most of the population have been taught that the Bible is a literal explanation of the past, when in fact, that Bible itself states it is allegorical and spoken in parables to break down the true meaning behind an infinite being known as the I Am for his finite beings that he created, you and I. Mary, in her dual nature, is the Virgin on one side, representing the age of Virgo, and the harlot on the other side, depicted by the Vatican, the VATICAN, as the harlot, mentioned in Revelation 17, verse 1 through 2, who under Rule 144 usurps the common law of the land, that's I Am's law, with the law of water, maritime admiralty, holy sea law, S-E-E. So to do this, the Vatican brings their war ship, because it is against I Am, for the warship or the watership to the land, and converting the land into a ship that makes claims to everyone born through the Holy Sea vessels. We're going to get into that. What exactly is the Holy Sea vessels? For example, in reality, ships come through the water canal to be docked. Meanwhile, the admiral provides a shipping manifest to properly identify the vessels the ship is delivering. That manifest is then certificated in its berth for the bank to control the money or currency of that particular land's economy. In the very same way or manner, our mothers, the admiral, delivers her vessel, that's the newborn, through her water canal to the dock, which the goods are manifested through a birth certificate registered with a parish priest, also known as the county registrar, for banking purposes with NASDAQ, the Depository Trust Corporation, and the stock market, Mar as in maritime, Stella Maris. Now ask yourself the question, what do banks do? Well, consequently, they direct the flow of the currency, just as the river banks direct the flow of the current. That's a statement by the great or the late Jordan Maxwell. All states are ships. And so when we enter their de facto federal religious courtrooms, we enter the dock on their holy warship under maritime admiralty law. This is why they ask for your docket number, AKA the case or indictment number. Now, I mentioned a parish priest, which is interesting to look into because it will connect the Vatican to each of us and give us insight as to what the 50 ships are here in North America and who operate them from the Vatican. Let's look at the ecclesiastical origins of a corporation. So, now I've gone over this in the past, but it's very important to understand it for this lesson in particular. It says a corporation soul is a legal entity consisting of a single soul incorporated office occupied by a single soul natural person. This structure allows corporations, often religious corporations or commonwealth governments, to pass without interruption from one office holder to the next, giving positions legal continuity with subsequent office holders having identical powers and possessions to their predecessors. A corporation soul is one of two types of corporation, the other being a corporation aggregate. Most corporation souls are church-related. For example, the Archbishop of Canterbury. Although some political offices of the United Kingdom, many of the Secretaries of State, Canada, and the United States are what? Corporation souls. The concept of corporation soul originated as a means for orderly transfer of ecclesiastical property, serving to keep a title within a denomination or religious society. And that tells you right there, it's all about money. You see, this is why there are so many different denominational sects in Christianity. You have Church of God, Church of Christ, Church of God in Christ, Baptists, Seventh-day Adventists. There's so many. And just like you have many denominations with our currency, $1 bill, $5 bill, $2 bill, $10 bill, $25, $50, and $100. Denominations are related to money, and who controls the printing of that money controls that nation. So in order to keep the religious property from being treated as the estate of the vicar of the church, the property was titled to the office of the corporation soul. In the case of the Catholic Church, ecclesiastical property is usually titled to the Dionysian bishop, who serves in the office of the corporation soul. The Catholic Church continues to use corporation souls in holding titles of property. As recently as 2002, it split a diocese in the U.S. state of California into smaller corporation souls, and with each parish priest becoming his own corporation soul, thus limiting the diocese liability for sexual abuse or other wrongful activity in which the priest might engage. So let's take a look at a parish priest, because I think that's important. It says a parish is a territorial entity in many Christian denominations, constituting a division within a diocese. A parish is under the pastoral care and clerical jurisdiction of a priest, often termed as parish priest, who might be assisted by one or more curates and who operates from a parish church. Right? So, in other words, if you operate within a 501c3, a federal agency, or you are a county registrar, you're acting in what's called an ex officio position. Let me continue so you know what that means. It says right here, by extension, the term parish refers not only to the territorial entity, but to the people of its community or congregation, as well as to church property within it. In England, this church property was technically in ownership of the parish priest ex officio, vested in him on his institution to that parish. Okay, so it's very important to know that. Now, I've given you other definitions such as church, circe. Circe is the original word for church. It's Greek. And most people say, well, I'm going to church on Sundays. You shouldn't say that. You should say you're going to congregate, not going to church. Church is a copyrighted Vatican name. And do you really want to know what's happening to the money that they collect? They don't tell you. It's very, very, it can be very disappointing if you really knew. So it's something to look into. Note, like I said, use the word congregate instead of church. Circe is a Greek goddess who would lure people of all ages by her seductive witchcraft to her house, accepting gifts and literal tithes unto her in exchange for blessing on the people. The people did not know that the word bless meant to consecrate by blood sacrifice, and she would devour them after receiving their worship. So click here and you'll see an image. This is the sorcery goddess Circe. And from this word, we get the word church. It's very sad how churchgoers, we're not told from an educational standpoint. It's just become a service. And it's time that we really, really stop and think and question all of these things to see if it's really what we should be about. There's a good side and there's a bad side to everyone. So education is important. So another word for parish, like I said, is ex officio, being a county registrar, vice president, secretary of state, ambassador of the United States to the Holy See, and plenipotentiary. You all should know this word. We use it. It's one of our trusty minutes, right? Representing the Holy See. So please stick to the end. During part three, I'm going to reveal the non-UCC documents and the UCC 3 termination and what you can do with it. It will make sense who these key offices are and how they have set up a way out for you and I when it comes to getting back to the common law of the land and out of the maritime Holy See. How many of you want to be left alone? How many of you just want to just run your business, earn what you earn throughout the year, doesn't have to be reported on, and you live your life? Place it in trust and you pass it on like they do. This is the sacred secret that they do not want you all to know about. I'm sure a lot of you want this. This is it. So it says all corporation souls, parish priests, county registrars, and the like who issue birth certificates and hold them as warehouse receipts are Catholic in origin. If you have a birth certificate from any country or certificate of naturalization, your current political status is Catholic under 501c3 right of privilege that can receive benefits from the federal government established after your country's declared bankruptcy. It does not matter if you are Christian, Islamic, Mormon, Buddhist, or you practice Judaism, all Catholic. All countries that issue and hold birth certificates are ran by the Italian, Black Venetian nobility families that have married with non-Melanite Italians, being the face of the Black nobility. And those families are the Farnese family, the Orsini family, House of Medici, which is where we get the word medical or medicine, the Cayetani, House of Pamphili, House of Paola Vicini. Let me say that again. Paola Vicini, Aldo Brandini, the Colonna family, they own North America. They're now known as the Colin family, the Borghese family, Erba Odescal. That's a hard one. Odescalchi. House of Sforza, right? All of these different families here, and there's more. House of Gonzaga, Visconti of Milan. We know what the word Visconti is. So all of these, it's just the beginning. There's more families out there that are running everything. They're running the Roman Catholic Church. They're running every 501c3 that is below them. This is it. These are them. Now, if you were to see pictures of these members of these families, that's just another veil for who's behind the scene. And they are of dark melanation. Melanated people. So now the Orsini is the original Rothschilds. They are the original Windsors and the Guelphs, which Queen Elizabeth That's where she came from. She came from the Guelphs. And it was the Orsini and the Colonna family who spent hundreds of years fighting in Rome to have a pope in power. There are three major popes, the white, black, and the gray. Eventually, one of the popes calls intermarrying to stop the endless bloodshed resulting in the Genoese family, hence where we get the word Genesis, as in the book of Genesis in the Bible. The Colonna family, now known as the Colin family, and they run Columbia Pictures, Knights of Columbia, the District of Columbia, British Columbia in Canada, the Colin Holdings with the Farnese family controlling the Pentagon. And yes, the Pentagon is part of this upgraded non-UCC as well. So you will see in the example that I give you, this is going to be all of my own personal recorded information. I always show my receipts and I show what it does. Okay. And you're going to see the Pentagon is there. So as you already know, the non-UCC is filed in response to the UCC-1 agriculture lien that was filed by the U.S. Treasury as the secured party on record against all land and all real legs and hands. That's you and I, e pluribus unum, meaning you and I covering the national public debt up to $14 quadrillion. I know I said in previous videos 14 trillion, but there are 15 zeros. Thank you all for pointing it out to me. It doesn't matter. Trillions, billions, quadrillions, that's still a lot of money. And I do not want to be responsible for paying that back for some corporation's mishaps. So let's take a look at the lien. You should all be familiar with this lien. This is the original file number. This is the acknowledged number, and this is the work order number. Now, they had a third party file this for them, which is the USA Department of Defense, Clerk of Hall of Justice. They're the ones who filed it. As you see, they are the ones listed in the as the entity to receive a certified copy of it once it is filed. It was filed in Maryland, right? Of course, maritime. This has to be filed in Maryland. Who are the debtors? Federal Reserve System, E pluribus unum, United States of America, another debtor, and they are connecting us in this term here, E pluribus unum. Who is the secure party? The United States Department of the Treasury, 1789. These serial numbers here, let's say one of these represents $20 trillion and another one represents 100 million and another one represents 12 quadrillion. It all adds up to the 14 quadrillion. And they place it under a commercial affidavit. Now they checked off right here that this is an agriculture lien. It is to be filed in the real estate section, but it is not checked off as a real lien against everyone. This is just an assumption. This backs up the lien that they've claimed on another part of our DNA material. I'm going to get into that. I'm going to show you how they actually have what's called subject matter jurisdiction. Do you actually know what that means? Why we use that term? Subject matter jurisdiction. We're gonna get into that in this video. So we've all seen this on the dollar bill. This note is legal tender for all debts, public and private. So when they finally get to this number here, you can expect a major change. We're still in the trillions. We've got a long way to go before we get to quadrillion. So that kind of gives you a little peace of mind that you're fine. Even though there's talks in the news right now, financial scare. Real estate's going to go up and down a bit. That's expected. So this is that original lien, and they have also attached a copy of the North American Water and Power Alliance. Right? And what they're showing you here in this map is how the world really works. This is not like what you have seen before. Look at how this is positioned. Right? And so what they're saying is all of these land masses are the common law, but what is surrounded outside of it? It's all about water. And there is more water than there is land. So by them setting up different federal agencies on this land, that's under the Roman Catholic Church, especially the hospitals under the sovereign order of Malta. And we're born in those hospitals, right? On this land, but if you're in their agencies that are on this land, then you're technically born on the water in their jurisdiction. So we're going to get into this, right? Let's go to next part. So this lien has placed all U.S. citizens, U.S. nationals, legal permanent residents, and state citizens responsible for all debts, public and private, regarding fees, commercial fines, penal fines, dues, imposts, federal taxes, state taxes, all collected to go into the hands of the Collin family. From there, I'm sure it is further distributed. In fact, they displayed their story in the famous Twilight Saga. You have the Collins of Italian nobility fighting with other Italian nobility houses, and the movie Twilight was distributed by Summit Entertainment. Take a look at this. Summit Entertainment, who is the owner? It's Lionsgate Entertainment, correct? If we were to look at this guy here, one of the producers, I believe, Andrew Vanna. It says here, Andrew Vanna was born in Budapest, a merchant of Jewish descent, and his wife, Clara. In 1956, at the age of 12, he fled from Hungary, and with the support of the Red Cross. Red Cross is always, look at the Red Cross and the Red Crescent Moon. Those are symbols of the orders that are connected to the Roman Catholic Church. He was always tied into it ever since the age of 12, and he made his way alone to Canada. Why? Because the Collin family, they own British Columbia in Canada. Look at the Twilight Saga, go back and watch that movie. You'll see what exactly they're showing you. They're showing the infighting between all of the nobility Italian families. They're vampires. We've heard the stories, what they do in Hollywood. So the agriculture lien follows for its debtors the right to remove or terminate the lien as it pertains to each debtor according to UCC subsection or Article 9509B. Let's take a look at that. Okay. Person entitled to file a record. A person may file an initial financing statement amendment that adds collateral covered by a financing statement or amendment that adds a debtor to a financing statement only if the debtor authorizes the filing in an authentic record or pursuant to subsection B. Tell me, did any of you authorize the IRS or anyone? Did you get notice? Did your parents get notice? A national notice to be listed as all real men with hands and legs and all real land in the United States of America. Were you aware? And them listing you as a debtor to this debt? No. So how do they have the right to do it? You're going to see. If the person holds an agriculture lien that has become effective at the time of filing, and the financing statement covers only collateral in which the person holds an agriculture lien, does that justify? I think not. Something must happen before this UCC-1 in order for the UCC-1 to take place, right? We had our promissory note first, and then the non-UCC took place. So what took place so that they can file their UCC-1 against all people? Let us know. Now, I have also a few case laws on the matter of UCC-1s having validity by way of debtor authorization. So the question is, how exactly have we become bound as debtors? All right, first, we need to break down into two parts, because we have all heard the term subject matter jurisdiction, like I said before, not knowing what this means or where it comes from. All right, so here's the first part. This is why we're going to do what we're doing, and this is how this UCC over here is existing. Let's talk about the first part, which is the subject. In 1582, the Pope Gregory, he took the Julian calendar, otherwise known as the Orthodox calendar or the calendar of the East. It is the Eastern sunrise calendar, and he changed it to the Gregorian or Anno Domini calendar, which is a timeline that is copyrighted by the Vatican. Using myself as an example, I, Avery Cottrell, born in the territory of Los Angeles in the nation of California, within the union of the several states of North America, in November, Anno Domini 1987. I was born into a copyrighted timeline, which the Vatican has a legitimate claim on that name. So, if I use that name within the copyrighted timeline, I am subjecting myself to a commercial system designed to own the characters born to it. When we realize that Avery Cottrell is a character associated with a copyrighted timeline, then we can realize that Pope Gregory is the author of a specific literary work. So let's define literary property. I'm going to look at the fifth edition of Black's Law Dictionary, and we're going to go to page 841. Go to page 841. All right, 841. I'm looking at literary property. Here we go. Literary property may be described as the right which entitles an author and his assigns, so that means Pope Gregory and all successors after him, to all the use and profit of his composition, to which no independent right is through any act or omission on his or their part vested in another person. Literary property is the exclusive right of owner to possess, use, and dispose of intellectual productions. The term denotes the corporal property in which an intellectual production is embodied, and it may consist of letters, lectures, sermons, or addresses. Okay? That is literary property. Now, let's go back. Key part here in that definition, it said the term denotes the corporal property in which an intellectual production is embodied. So, let's give another example. Everyone knows Star Wars, right? Everybody knows Star Wars, which was created by George Lucas, and he also created the Indiana Jones franchises. If I had decided to dress up as Darth Vader and speak like Earl Jones, the original, or wear a CP3O android outfit, the golden one, George Lucas has a legitimate claim on everything I do by wearing that character. He could, literally. It's his literary property. So when I wake up tomorrow and put on the character or use the character Avery Cottrell, the Vatican has a legitimate claim on all the production and activity that I create. Why? Because my name is born in the Anno Domini calendar timeline. We're all subjected to their timeline, because if we didn't go by that, if we went by the ancient Hebrew calendar, it's actually the year 5,000 and something. We are 3,000 years in the past by being in the year 2023. So this is the subject of Avery Cottrell. And that subject was born to a copyrighted timeline that has been in existence since 1582. Isn't that interesting how this timeline began right when the King James Version Bible was being produced by King James? And Pope Gregory and all successors have a copyright to that world. Okay? So what the Vatican did was create a commercial position, and so that character, Avery Cottrell, is a commercial character which is syndicated. Now, if I'm using the very same name of the character they have a claim to, I am subscribing to it. And to subscribe to it is to underwrite to it. A ritual standing under their commercial position, which makes me the guarantor. I would guarantee any and all payments due to the Vatican, which is the owner, as a sense of guaranteed royalty dues for fines, fees, impost, duties, taxes, which the entire credit system is based upon. So without that name, they have nothing. You may or may not know, or you may or may not see, why I beseech all of you to discover and find your title of nobility name based on your family lineage. Get a name. Separate yourself from that copyrighted timeline. Okay? So now here's the terrifying part. Okay, we've heard the term subject matter jurisdiction and reviewed the subject. The subject is the title, the name on the birth certificate title. That's a certificated title, a security. We understand that. Now, how do we understand the matter? Matter is very intriguing and yet disturbing, but I think you guys can handle it. So how do they attach the matter to the subject? All right? Pay close attention. Using myself again, which applies to all of us, my mother goes into a federal religious tax-exempt facility named Cedars-Sinai Hospital in Beverly Hills, California, the Republic. She didn't know any of that. All she knows is she has a baby boy in her womb. Okay. Now, did she stop by customs and declare the package that she is carrying? No. When she delivers the package in her womb in federal territory, does she declare that delivery? Nope. When she wraps the package in clothing, Does she declare that package on her way out of federal territory? No, she doesn't. So then what is the package that she delivered? That's me, baby Avery. And there is no evidence of my existence since I arrived, but here's what they do. Since the beginning of time, when a woman delivers a baby, there is a second delivery called afterbirth. The afterbirth is legally called born alive. This is the second delivery, or in the words of the Vatican, the second coming. The scary part about the afterbirth material is that when mom takes me home, there's no physical evidence of me at all. So what they do is take the left behind afterbirth material, the DNA material, and because nobody claims it, it gets salvaged. Why? Simply put, we are in our mother's water. And we're delivered through that water in an amniotic sac. That is our mother's ship, the vessel in mother's water that we're traveling in, and it crashes ashore after we're delivered. So we are the firstborn, and the secondborn is the left behind afterbirth material vessel. And they salvage that wreckage and receive a salvage lien against it. There's your debt. That's the charge. From there, it is as simple as taking the paperwork our mothers left behind and applied to the salvage wreckage. Now, the afterbirth material has a name. What is that name exactly? Well, in my case, Avery Cottrell is now attached to the second coming DNA afterbirth material. That is the matter. The subject is the birth certificate title. The matter is the afterbirth DNA material that is salvaged. Now let's look at the legal term for afterbirth material, which is called born alive. Let's go to page 167, Black's Law Dictionary. 167. Here we are, born alive, right here. Being the product of conception after complete expulsion or extraction from mother, irrespective of the duration of the pregnancy, which breathes or shows any other evidence of life, such as beating of the heart, pulsation of the umbilical cord, or definite movement of voluntary muscles, whether or not the umbilical cord has been cut or the placenta is attached. Each product of such birth is considered, listen to this, each product of such birth is considered live born and fully recognized as a human person. Did you catch that? The key part here, like I said, each product of such birth is considered live born and fully recognized as a human person. Wow. So the waste material that's left behind in an actual is an actual human person that is leaned. The afterbirth material is also called a foundling. Let's go to page 591 and look at that definition. A foundling. Because it's left behind, mom didn't claim it. I see why home births are now the way to go. And not to cut the umbilical cord right away. It's filled with nutrients. Here it is, foundling. A deserted or abandoned infant, a child found without a parent or guardian, its relatives being unknown. So if the afterbirth DNA material is considered to be a human person and it is deserted, it's abandoned, it's a child found without any guardianship or parents, so yes, the afterbirth material is considered a foundling. That's the matter. This is all left behind DNA waste material, and it's a child of God, and it's defective. It does not have a head or arms or legs like the agriculture lien describes, but the church calls it a child of God, so they must salvage it. And salvage, the word salvage and salvation are the same word. So when mom takes baby Avery home, the left behind afterbirth born alive child of God has no known parents. The state takes possession and becomes a ward of the state. And there is the charge to the state. Everything is based upon that foundling where the state created the child. And from that point forward, all we are when we step into court is a relative of that defective ens legis character. That is the matter completing the subject matter jurisdiction. That's how they have subject matter jurisdiction when you walk in the court. It doesn't matter what you say. And this is why we said, at least step into court with your DBA to show that the trust is doing business in that name. Why? Because yes, they may have this UCC-1 on all real men with hands and legs, but they don't have anything on your name. They don't have it. So at least your DBA will help you there. So let's continue. So let's explain how the Pope views you, the Christ, and themselves as the Vicarius Filii Dei. They are the vicar, the one standing in place of Christ for salvation. So going back to my mother giving me the name Avery, this is my given Christian name. Right, look at a Christian name in Black's Law on page 219. Let's take a look right now. Let's get it out of the way. 219. Christian name. There it is. Christian name. The baptismal name as distinct from the surname. See, most people thought that your first and last name was a Christian name. No, it's just your first given name alone. The name which is given one after his birth. My mother gave me Avery. She didn't give me Avery Cottrell. Cottrell is just a family name that's going to automatically go with the given name. So the surname is my last name. Okay. So, and that's going to connect me to I Am's Law of the Land. Just my given Christian name, Avery. That's it. This connects me to I Am's Law of the Land. Like I said, when I say I Am, that's saying his name, but it's also saying where he is in me. So all I have to say is Avery, and I said his name. I referred to him. So when you look at Romans 10, verse 13, it says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, salvaged. That's not Jehovah. That's not Yahweh. It's not Yahuwah. It's not even Yah. My family name is Cottrell, the last name, but the Roman Catholic Church calls it a surname, which is your surety's name. If I use that last name, I'm saying I am just surety for someone else's debts, because that first and last is attached to what? That subject matter jurisdiction, that lien that they have placed on that salvage title for the afterbirth DNA material, but they don't have just Avery by itself. This is the given name that I am saved by. So what I'm saying is this is the common law born on the land name, and Avery Cottrell is the maritime name. Okay, so the word sir gives me sir and further provides me with Mr. or Miss, which belongs to the Vatican in order to bring me onto the ship as Mr. Cottrell or Mr. Avery Cottrell or Sir Avery Cottrell, and all caps corporate name under Roman law as Capitis Diminutio. So the following would apply. If you were to click this link, it's going to give you the definition for every single three levels of Capitis Diminutio. So in this sense, all lowercase, that is minima, that is the rights of liberty unaltered. However, I don't want to use that. If I wanted to have something after my name, I would use my title nobility. If I use it in this sense, where the first letters are capital, that's media. That's loss of rights, of family rights and citizenship, but without losing liberty. And full caps is maxima. That means to change from one of freedom at birth to one of bondage, becoming a slave. So the forms media and maxima are now on the Vatican citizenship. You will now notice, or you may have noticed this before in the past, some police officers doing a traffic stop, no matter if the traveler is a male or female that they pull over, the officer will call them sir, even if it's a female, because sir is, they know when they do that, they're trying to, like I said, this is a contract they're getting ready to do with you. So putting you under the subjecting you to the sir makes you that surety for a debt, which is their debts, and they want you to pay for it. So in actuality, the officers are the sirs, because they're the ones who are the sirs on behalf of the bankrupt corporation seeking to contract with the maxima person. We are not sirs or sirs, because we have been ordered by I am to never become surety of someone else's debt. That's Proverbs 22 verses 26. So the lowercase Avery is the name that Christ saves, because it's on the land. And you guys need to know what this is. I'm not going to get into it in this video. That would be so long. But you need to really, really know what this is. It's in all of you. Now, Avery is the name that Christ saves because it's on the land. Whereas the surname, Cottrell, cannot be saved. Avery Cottrell is pagan to the common law, otherwise known as pay again. And that's exactly what's happening. Double dipping everywhere I turn. Paying 96% in taxes all day long using this name. Using the benefits that come with this name, right? Pagan is pay again. Now, this brings us into Pope and their harlotry scheme, as spoken of in the book of Revelations, to bring you into their jurisdiction. Now, I mentioned Revelation 17, verse 1 and 2 above, and now knowing about maritime and the Vatican, see if you can connect the dots to this scripture. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on the many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication. and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Question: who is the harlot that sits on many waters? Easy, that will be the Vatican or the Roman Catholic Church using treaties to take over the lands of many countries, such as the UNIDROIT. Have you heard of the UNIDROIT? Click on this link, it'll lead you here. The UNIDROIT, let's look at the purpose of the UNIDROIT, which stands for, what does it stand for? It'll tell us. The International Institute for the Unification of Private Law, otherwise known as UNIDROIT, is an independent intergovernmental organization with its seat in the Villa Aldobrandini. That's one of the top families in Rome. Its purpose is to study needs and methods for modernizing, harmonizing, and coordinating private and, in particular, commercial law as between states and groups of states, and to formulate uniform law instruments, principles, and rules to achieve those objections. There, almost every country is a part of UNIDROIT. And guess who owns it? The Aldobrandini family. It's not a coincidence. So, that is going to conclude part one. We will continue in part two. And as we get to part three, there is where you're going to find the information that you need, how to put all of this together and get this done. All right, so that's going to be it for part one. I'll see you in part two.